good afternoon, Sovereign of the Seas. This is your cruise director, Keith. And did you know this is day 12 of our revitalization project? Keep up the great work, be safe, and have a wonderful afternoon on board the Sovereign of the Seas.
Royal Caribbean International's Sovereign of the Seas was designed in the mid-80s without balconies in any of the staterooms. But balconies have become necessary to compete in the cruise ship industry. So the Hotworks team is installing 61 of them to deck 10.
Most cruise ships are built with 60% balconies, and this one has zero. We don't have a lot of balconies, but at least we have something. I managed the installation of what we call the mock-up cabin, which is where we did one of these to see how it actually would look, to see if we liked the design and everything. And that went really smooth, so now it's just a matter of getting the contractors working hard.
When are you going to start cutting?
Just as soon as they get power.
There's no power, huh?
Nope.
They're not using a torch?
There's some. Some places they are using a torch.
Power outage is killing my schedule. I can't do any of the jobs that we needed to get done today. The aft area is shut down, the balconies are shut down. And it wasn't planned, and nobody told us about it, so at least we could have been prepared for it.
When I got on board right before we started the dry dock, it was like a high. And then it hit the dry dock fever period, where I've been kind of like, wow, we're not going to finish.
We've got over that initial rush of, okay, we're started now, the shackles are off, we can get going. But the finish line is still a long way in sight.
As we get a few days into the dry dock, we start to see this kind of like glazed look come over people's faces. There's no other way of describing it other than dry dock fever. The hardest part of dry dock is the living conditions.
You work 12 hours a day and you go down your cabin, there's no water, or you can't flush your toilet.
No air conditioning, no toilets.
Everyone's anxious to get the job done because they want to get back to their families.
If they ran out of beer or cigarettes right now, it would probably be a mutiny.
The Royal Caribbean has decided to do this in 3 weeks, which, in our opinion, you need about 6 weeks.
They have so much to do. Everything's apart. I have no clue how they're going to get this done.
We are a little behind, and that worries me a lot because you don't have the time to recuperate.
Throughout the project, it frequently feels like we're not going to get everything together on time. We can't pull this off. How are we going to pull this off?
Historically, within Royal Caribbean, the windjammer projects seem to be the ones that have caused most of the problems.
We built to the wrong drawings. But we had to somehow get this to fit when we brought everything down, and that causes it to stress. We start having cracks in the welds. About 25% of the structure is cracked. The DNV is the classification society that approves structural issues. They want us to open up two seams to relieve the pressure.
The timeline is so tight of getting this in and getting it complete, we're going to be probably completing going right into the end of the dry dock.
We're pushing our guys 16, 19 hours a day. And there's no other alternative than kill yourself to get it done, basically.
I'm getting nervous about at the end of the line, there's going to be things that haven't been done and finished, and I didn't do it because I didn't realize I needed to do it. And that's been my biggest fear.
So honestly, do you think we're going to be done?
I can't say anything. I don't want to be the one saying that we're not going to finish.
From my side, we need to know realistically what we could potentially be facing because we need a contingency plan. It's not about failure. It's about just being honest with the communication.
At the rate it's going now, we're not going to finish. They can make it given they get this container at this time. But until we can determine whether that container's going to show up or whether they get those parts.
We're just reaching the critical point in terms of timing. And we were right on schedule, but the materials showing up is what's been causing the delays. And obviously, without the materials, we can't do the work. All right. Yeah. All right, super. Thanks, Christian.
This container that's lost, we've been trying for almost a week to find it. Just been one phone call after another.
What I need you to do, I don't care if you have to drive up and sit in his damn lap. I'll call Raphael, and if they told him that, I'll give him a peace of mind, too.
I'm trying to get to my first cigar, and by the end of the day, if I keep working on this one, it'll be on a two or three cigar day.
Let's not get them pissed off at this point. They need to help us.
When you go to a port the size of Miami and you say, we've lost a container, that's the honest truth. It's a physical item. If they can't find it, they can't find it.
All right, as soon as you get that, email it to me. My email's up and operational.
They're taking their time coming back from lunch today.
As refurbishment specialist, I am responsible for the riding crew.
I've got some missing people. Everybody eats every day from 11 to 12. The lines are long at lunch, so I don't really worry about 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 25 minutes. We have a problem. I am looking for those guys on Team 2 that were doing the painting. You haven't seen them? No. You know Team 2, right? You don't know. Do you know Team 2? No of them. Did you see them at lunch? Nobody knows them. They're phantoms. Okay, now I'm going hunting. I've lost a couple of my guys. Can you give me their cabin numbers?
Let me just plug in the computer. Only giving you this information because I know you are the boss.
Adrenaline rush of getting started is over, as the project team now faces fatigue and stress. Suzanne Nelson has been searching the ship, trying to find some workers who didn't show up after their lunch break.
Okay, it's a problem. You're smoking in the room. It's against the rules. And you guys are 45 minutes late coming back from lunch. Amanda, this is Suzanne.
Go ahead, Amanda.
I have a big problem. Could you come to cabin 2043, please? Just hold it.
Yeah, okay.
Hold it. So my guys don't report back at noon. Man, we're smoking up a storm and we're 45 minutes late. And when I open the door, the smoke assails me, so we got two issues here.
So why did we not go back to work on time?
I have an alarm clock.
Uh-huh.
I could not make the phone work for the wake-up call.
The phone's not working?
Yeah. We gotta just wait.
The phone's working fine. Guys, the phone's working fine. Okay, let's stick with the truth, okay? So the phone's working, you know how to make a wake-up call. I find it a little hard to believe that all four of you overslept and not one of you woke up and woke the others up. You're very late for work and you're violating the regulations on board by smoking in the cabins. If we catch you smoking in the cabins again, then we'll need to take disciplinary action, okay? We understand the problem, yeah? And if it happens again, then we'll...
Sorry, it's already prepared.
Okay. All right, gentlemen, let's get back to work.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Actually, they have been so good for so long, it's probably my fault because I've been less tough about making them report in. Now the relationship that we've had, or we apparently had, you know, is different.
Amanda, George Derby.
Do you happen to have one of these hotel radios that we can leave down in the container down here?
The container is my office. Normally, I don't have it nearly that good. It helps considerably to be able to get out of the sun, someplace to sit down at a desk, have a phone, and to be able to work right there. Oh, yeah, we got a spot for my little humidor.
Those first few puffs, they just calmed me down.
It's George Derby.
Oh, don't you feel lucky now? I can hear the change in your voice already. The container was found. Hallelujah. Hey, Kevin, it's George. They found my container. The one that's been lost. All right, I will talk to you later. Bye. Yes, something's happening good.
We've been looking at the schedule and we really need to push the balcony work. The material's here now. We need to get them finished with the hot work. We've had a lot of issues with safety and concern about fires. It's a high-risk environment because you have sparks and everything. So when that hot work is finished, it really relieves the stress from a safety aspect. The quicker we get hot work done, the better it is for everybody.
Message to all fire teams. This is the captain. Message to all fire teams. Stand by at your stations. Stand by at your stations.
Shipping dry dock is a very vulnerable place to be, particularly when it comes to fire.
When there is a fire and you hear a Bravo,
I'm running to the scene.
Storm's going to reach the technology.
Where's it coming from?
Fires, they are imminent. They will happen.
I heard some discussion on the radio, and there has been a fire. It was detected on the bridge.
And then seconds, as you know, in this kind of situations, they are counting. It's not minutes, it's seconds.
I've been in dry docks where I've seen ships gutted within 5-10 minutes.
And it was one deck below the bridge, which is where we launched lifeboats, and that's where a piece of debris fell.
It's a rag supported by the wing.
Okay, we have established.
Fire extinguished.
But we have not established the cause of fire.
We've not established why.
It's ventilation filters, not fire blanket.
No, it's here. This is a fire blanket.
I actually timed the last Bravo, which was less than 28 seconds. At least 4 senior officers were on the spot.
Can you inform the captain?
That's, to my opinion, a remarkable record.
I ran from the pier to deck 11. So I'm just all adrenaline right now.
The cabins were prefabricated to save time. But now, as we've been going through it, they've been making a lot of changes. There was a lot of design mistakes that they haven't checked or verified.
Amika?
Yeah.
What are these wires coming
out? I'm just having trouble understanding it because it seems exceptionally high for the telephone, and I don't know what this is.
Seems exceptionally big.
The interior of the cabins has been somewhat of a struggle. We've run into a few issues with getting the work completed.
How come we haven't got a seal up here? Come on, fellas. Let's get moving.
The contractors and ourselves are working very, very long hours. We don't want people getting too tired that they make mistakes, because mistakes can cost us time.
Presently, you should look at all these areas. They are starting now to get really beaten up already.
The place looks a mess.
The whole idea of building them in the factory is so you don't get any mess on board the ship.
I don't know how we're going to get this done on time.
It wasn't like this 24 hours ago.
My concern is the passage. Can we put it here? We have a process that we go through with the contractor. Tell me if I'm asking for something impossible. To darken this a little more towards the molding on that. So they have already a mindset in what we want. We are missing a little, this tiny, tiny edge in here, right?
It looks very creamy here.
Creamy, yeah.
For some reason.
That sample looks very good there.
All this is very nice. It's very well integrated and it looks fine with the rail.
The issue is that the fabrication of the 2 new showers is not what we had agreed.
The proportion between the size of the glass and the framing looks fine, and the integration with this element came out very well. So, when I came earlier, they had one element coming from this point to this point. I measured it and it was 1,950 millimeters. That is a huge problem for us because it's a liability issue. If we have anything lower than 2,050 millimeters and we have a passenger that hit that, like I would, we are liable for it. So definitely we have to figure out the structure in a way that we don't require this element at all. We cannot accept it. So now we have to come up with a solution that liability-wise is okay, more than anything else, passenger security-wise is okay, and aesthetically speaking, would work.
You can't get away without the cross rail at the top, Carlos. It will still flex.
Sorry about this whole issue, but...
No. We'll approve the drawings.
Problems are on the rise, and the project team has only 9 days before passengers reboard the ship. Senior architect Carlos Reyes is taking issue with the building of the showers next to the jacuzzis.
Sorry about this whole issue, but we gotta make it work right.
We'll approve the drawings.
We gotta make it work right anyway. One of the guys asked, who approved the drawings? So I didn't want to make a big deal, but I pulled their manager away.
Dennis!
And I told him that that structural element was not in the drawings.
the drawings didn't show that element on top.
No.
You know?
No.
When you alter a specification of something, it has a domino effect. And the domino effect is that now, structurally speaking, it won't hold. But we have to come with another solution. And I need to have this done the first day we have passengers here. How about if we do this? Now it clears more than 2010. We are altering the design, but it cannot look like it's an afterthought.
I came up to Sovereign to see how the progress was going, or the maintenance of the lifeboats. But I also came down to have the ship from a different perspective, you know. I spent 6 years on the Sovereign now, and she has taken care of us for so many years, and she has been in service since 88. And every so often, we have to do this to her and put her into dry dock and shine her up again. And 24 hours a day operation, and so intense, and it's a high-stress working environment. At the same time, it's a very tight community. We're living together, we work together. We don't have any way to blow off steam, you know. We have to deal with our issues every day, 7 days a week. You definitely get caught up in it. It's a lifestyle. Hard to understand unless you have done it yourself.
The Crown and Anchor logo used to be lit up by neon, but it has not been working for 5 years. The only way you're going to change out the lights is taking down the Crown and Anchor. Neon lasts for 5 years, that's it. We need to find another option. You're going to switch them on. LEDs will last about 100,000 hours, which we calculated about 20 years.
Our priority is to get these containers for all our carpeting that were delayed out of New York. And we've just now got them at a Freeport this morning, so we're working on those for today.
It's very frustrating to be waiting for containers full of carpet. This was a shipment that got held up in customs in New York. The shipment should have reached us in Port Everglades.
We gotta get going here, guys.
From the minute things settled down, we should have been working on the stairs. The stairs should never have been a factor in the last 10 days. But the carpet got here in the middle of the docking.
I would like to be down this side with the landings done tonight. That would be my goal.
50,000 meters worth of carpet, it's a huge number. It's a little bit like, instead of carpeting a house, it's a little bit like carpeting a subdivision. It's beyond belief.
The dry dock fever phase is that you've been working really hard for over a week and a half, and they're not seeing their results, and they don't feel like anything's happening, and they start getting antsy. Is it going to get finished? Are they going to see it? You've got to get past that and realize that it doesn't get that nice finished look until the very end.
Now our new ships, they have a state-of-the-art theater from any point of view. Seating, accommodation, service, lighting, sound. Our objective is to bring this one up to that level.
So basically, this is what we achieve in the seating arrangement. We have about 40 more prime location seats versus what we had before.
For us, what is most important is to give them the center unobstructed view. That's our goal.
Let's bring the cushion. But do we have material for it?
The banquette structure was too low. So when you sit, the handrail in front will be exactly at your eyes, and it was very uncomfortable. I thought we were going to put the booster in all of them.
But you don't, it's not needed if you're too high on
it. It is. We put some structure underneath to lift a little the seats. I want to see that the issue that we addressed with the height is being corrected.
I see perfect. I see the railing above this railing.
It's amazing, but that much makes a huge difference.
Yeah.
Now you see it and you can see perfect.
Okay, any issues people want to raise?
No issues from last night, thank you.
Good. Captain.
Weather today is going to be cloudy. The wind down here, it can build up within a half an hour. We can have 40 miles here. It is unpredictable in the Bahamas of this time of the year.
The wind might become very strong down here.
In the later afternoons, you may get a lot of wind. And so we need to work as quickly as possible. It takes a pretty good amount of wind to stop this crane. It is computerized, and at some point, the wind will stop the crane. It'll just stop. The computer will not allow it to run.
If we get really strong winds and we can't load containers, we can't load material, work will stop. A few contractors are getting a little bit worried about some of their materials, so it can be very frustrating for them.
Tell George we're shutting it down. Shut the crane down. It's too windy.
Freeport on Grand Bahama Island. The strong winds that caused several delays have finally died down, and the project team now has a precious 8 days to get the job completed.
Got all excited last night because we thought we were getting carpet, but then the wind picked up and the crane stopped. Just now they've started the heavy lifts. We're hoping to get some carpet. Are they setting it up or no?
They're on 15-minute break.
Break time. I'm all for it.
We got rid of the wind, the weather's improved, so things are moving along quite nicely today.
It's frustrating to wait for the materials. We were 9 days behind yesterday, now we're 10 days behind. It has a label on it. They said it was corridor, right? What does the corridor say? Corridor. We need to get started. Each stair has to be wrapped and the little metal strip attached to it, padding on the top. It takes some time. We need to get started.
Well, a very good afternoon, Sovereign of the Seas. It is day 15 of dry dock. You guys are working hard. Things are looking good and getting there. So kick it into high gear, folks. You're all fabulous out there. I know you can do it.
It's groundhog day. Every day seems to be the same. So it's the constant running around. It's getting tiring now.
For me, it's been 2.5 weeks. I'm beat.
It's a noisy, dusty, dirty environment.
I was up till past 3 a.m. last night. I tried to sleep in, but then they started pounding with a jackhammer.
Most of the guys, they've been in dry docks. They bring their little fans with them. They come prepared, you know?
I've been to a few dry docks. They're nothing like this.
I've had incidents where the hot water's been off. I go down to a tea machine and fill up a 5-gallon bucket with hot water and bring it to my cabin to take a sponge bath.
It's very, very hard to be away for long periods of time from the people that you love.
My girlfriend, she probably thinks I'm breaking up with her because I haven't talked to her in so long.
I want to get home for Christmas.
We're all working very, very long hours. When people start to get tired, they can get a little fractious.
Guys, don't keep bringing this carpet in here.
That's something we don't need with our time frame out here.
So the middle of the project is a key time for us.
Today, my day is going to be mostly focused on the balcony work. We're starting to lay the plates down and everything, so we'll see what happens. So where's this plate going?
This is that one.
Now, what are they using this chain there for? And then once it goes on, what do you have to do then? I think I'm up there a little bit too much pestering the balcony guys because I want them to finish. You went in the wrong way, huh?
Oh, man, I thought it was wrong.
See? And then the next one has to come this way than that one.
Correct.
They'll figure it out. I take every problem as it's a huge problem. And that's just the lack of experience. I don't know which problems really need to be dealt with and which don't. So I've been taking them all just as seriously.
They better figure it out or I'll go up there and show them.
Relax, Christian. Go away from the sheep for a couple of hours.
I know, I need to get the hell out of here.
They told me I needed to relax and go have a beer and come back tomorrow. So we'll see what happens. All right.
All righty.
Finally got satellite TV. They were doing weather around the world and there was this monstrous typhoon. Then it said it hit the northern part of the Philippines or was crossing it then and going on to Taiwan. So later in the afternoon, I asked him.
The typhoon is big, even in Visayas region is affected.
Some people died, I don't know how many.
1,000.
Almost 1,000. People died.
The strongest typhoon ever to hit the north of the Philippines. Strongest and recorded whatever's.
And this has happened or it's on its way?
It's there now.
Okay.
And they are very apprehensive for information, weather information, news.
Have they tried calling home or you don't know?
No. I don't think they've tried.
Okay, because we can set it up. So just take one into an office, have them make a call and try and get some information from home. Would that help? Suzanne came to me today to tell me that there'd been a typhoon hit the Philippines and some of her team were really worried. So we're going to open up the phone lines so that they can call home and check on their families and see if everything's okay.
Okay, I've got my code, it should go through. Now the big question.
Members of Suzanne Nelson's Filipino riding crew are desperately trying to reach loved ones in the Philippines after they receive news that a powerful typhoon swept through the country.
No answer? The lines must be messed up. We'll try again tomorrow. Okay? Sorry, Adami.
They're worried. I'd be worried.
Some of the equipment that it was fitted in Windjammer had to come out because it was too high, so we had to adjust the bases. So that's knocked us back a couple of hours today in that area. Windjammer is always going to look probably the worst because it's physically one of the largest bases that we're doing the work in. So it's always been a challenge, and I think there are some people who visit the area and think it's going to be impossible, we'll never get it done.
Good. Push, push.
Are these the riding crew who's helping?
Or it's like our crew.
The buffer counter slipped, and one gentleman got his leg trapped and caused quite a bad cut to it.
Can you walk, or you want me to get a wheelchair up?
He's right there, so I ran over to him. And he was trying to stand up and couldn't put weight on it, so I was trying to get him to put his weight on me. For some reason, he wasn't comfortable doing that, and two of the really strong bar guys came up, just picked him up and carried him to the elevator. So we all went down to the medical facility.
Okay, I'm just going to JP move this. This you can move. Any pain if I do that?
Yeah.
Can you move the foot to the inside at all? Okay, we'll take an x-ray and we'll see.
All right, Vilma, I think he's in good hands now. I know he's with you, so I'll leave you to it.
Okay.
All right. Initially, it was hard to see what he'd done and how badly he was hurt because he had trouble standing up and couldn't put any weight on it. But he actually just had a very bad cut. Fortunately, no breaks or anything.
Yeah, captain off the ship. I'm going down to the lifeboats.
Copy that.
We're going to take a look at the lifeboats. We're going to have a full overhaul of the lifeboats as well. Repaint them a new canvas and check the engine and release mechanism and the main engines and so forth. You're going to be on time. Are we ready with the lifeboats on December the 6th?
Yep, no paint's coming.
No paint?
No paint's coming.
No paint? Yeah, it's regarding the paint. There is no paint.
Don't be working on it.
All right, copy that.
I hadn't gotten to my first cigar yet today because I've been so busy looking for paint. Two small boxes of all-grip paint were shipped to Miami. Apparently, somewhere along the way, they're misplaced or shipped to another island, or they could still be sitting in a pile no one has found yet. We spent at least 2 hours this morning looking for his boxes, and we did not find them. So as far as I'm concerned, right now they're not on island, and I've asked him to reorder that paint.
Well, the typhoon has now passed through the Philippines, but a lot of these people are without the ability to communicate with their families. There's really no way to do wholesale phone access. The only way is to use my passcode. So we're doing that on a, as long as I can stay awake, basis. I'm gonna make six calls to the Philippines tonight. I'm gonna write a number down. And the person who guesses the number is between 1 and 50. Okay, give me your name and numbers. Okay, Jose, what's your number? It's amazing how much of the world operates on cell phones. The phones that these guys are trying to reach are, by and large, cell phones. And without power, the cell phones have lost their ability to receive signal. Taylor is what?
Okay,
is that
everybody
it?
Has a number.
Okay. Here is the number.
24.
36. 36.
The following people get a free call to the Philippines tonight. Buenaventura?
Yes.
Taylor Delord? Loretta?
Mendoza.
Barcia?
Cabanes.
Vandalian, Mendoza. Okay, guys, let's go make some calls. We have to go down to the facility manager's office. I think it'd probably be better if we waited out in the hall in case he does get his wife and he wants to say something sweet. Thank you. We got to keep it at about 6 or 7 minutes or I'll be asleep by the time all these calls are made.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. Everything is okay?
Yeah, everything's done. Thanks a lot.
Hello, tawagin mo si mama mo. Hello, si papa to. Tawagin si mama.
The most important things to my family and my kids. I have 2 kids, and this is my wife. I will show up to the pictures, and this is my wife, and this is my babies.
Suzanne came back to me to tell me that a lot of the Filipino crew had been able to make contact with their family and speak to them, and that some of their houses had been damaged, some of their crops had been lost, but their families were all okay. All the people at home were fine, so that was a big relief for everyone.
This is your cruise director, Keith, coming at you live. We got something special planned for you. It is Crazy Hat Night on the back deck. When you're finished your shift, come on back, enjoy a few beers. Join the fun. We'll see you later. Back deck. Right now, I have to go make a hat.
It's not a normal living situation. It's hot sometimes. There's no water sometimes. They're stressed out. We have to find a way for the crew members to let off some steam and relax. You know, you got to keep the spirits high or you're going to have a whole bunch of miserable people walk around and you want your crew members to be happy.
A few members of the team are heading ashore to go for a dinner in Port Lucaya, which is close to the shipyard. Everybody's worked pretty hard for the last 2 weeks. It's been a bit intense, so it's a chance to unwind for a little bit and just relax.
Tonight was really nice. It was really, felt really good to get off the ship.
It was nice that the whole team could get together and hang out and just pretend like we're normal people. We're not stuck on the ship all the time and not worried about all the issues and the stresses of the ship that affect us all night. And I got to see Amanda in a nice light. I realized that we have this connection that she just doesn't want to talk about.
Yeah, it was like our first date. Yeah.
I think it was good that we all got out. It's just a good break in the middle of the project so that we can laugh about this the next couple nights and keep the momentum going into the final phase.
The project team hopes a night out on the town in Freeport, Bahamas has recharged their batteries and cured the ills of dry dock fever.
Are we getting any detainers on or what?
Because it's always...
Well, come on, man. We sat up. Were you there until we went to bed last night?
Yeah.
What was it, 3?
2:30, called it 3.
Oh, man. It was fun.
It was good.
You can't do that every night, though, huh?
Oh, no. I think the piece itself came out very nice, and the woodwork very nice, but this, we have to do something.
Carlos, if you put it all the way up against the POS, there was an unequal...
width. Yeah.
Condition on this side, it looked worse.
That's clear. Do you think it would be possible maybe to make a filler?
Sure.
We have to check, then we have to re-laminate this one on the way to the end.
Why don't we set it back and make it work?
Okay, deal.
With 6 days left, it's always a nervous time because there's still so much to do. The time starts running down. We'll run out of tomorrows. There will be no tomorrows left. So it is important that we concentrate on getting things finished and being able to hand them back to operations.
So this is going
to
be clean, right?
Yes.
Okay. It's really deep cleaning. Yeah. Look at this. You want to see the tray.
We should be able to take possession of some of the shops and give those back to our retail people.
So approved. Very, very nice, Dean, as always.
Your turn.
Thank you very much.
I'm sorry it's not a very fancy pen. Thank you.
Beautiful job, as always. Thank you. Probably the nicest surprises of all is that the shop's area were ready for inspection, which is a lot earlier than what I was thinking in terms of programming. So that was a very, very good surprise. And they did a very good job. It's very, very nice in every single shop. Thank you very, very much.
Oh, it's a pleasure.
Perfect. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
When we actually finally got to do the inspections of the new cabins on deck number 2, the inspections actually went very, very well. I believe that the bed frames are the wrong size.
The bed that was ordered isn't the right size, so they've already made it, put in a new order, and we'll have those replaced before we put those into service.
You want to see a major issue?
Yeah.
Check out the signage that the boys put up. It's kind of cute.
That wasn't the word I was looking for.
Do we have the layout with the right numbers on?
Yeah, yeah. But we might be missing the signs.
It's 23 nice brand new cabins, which they can use. I think they'll be a good addition for the ship.
Everything that's on this list is okay?
Mm-hmm. They've been corrected.
Everything's corrected.
If I get fired, I'm blaming you, Deborah.
That's why you should let me sign it.
Yeah, exactly.
This is Christian Compton. He's the one responsible for the drawings in this room.
The IT department came out with the layout, but when they got on board, they realized when they took the ceilings down that there was this cooling unit above the computer. Can I put that under that?
Why not?
Because that's $500,000 and the whole ship goes to shit.
You would like to... This will be moved. Oh, wait. Come on.
The AC unit was right above the computer that controls passengers and crew information.
And we agreed that we put the new copper butt would be there.
Yeah, but he can't agree to that because he has been given clear instructions that all ships...
And underneath that is coming plate.
Doesn't matter. It could leak. No computer should be under any source of water.
Especially that one.
So why not put the rack here? And just going around this direction.
Do you have that much distance here? So we're trying to figure out how we can relocate the computer or relocate the air conditioning unit. So what was the size of the rack?
700.
So we can't, like, move that one there, then?
He just wants to move the unit.
So what's the size, what's the length of this versus this?
I'm truly concerned to get our computer room up and ready because we're at the deadline.
Rearrange the puzzle. So now Dominic is going to make some changes in the room as far as cabling, and then they'll work out a solution that everybody's happy with.
We've given this clock a reprieve about 3 times already, and it's had a stay of execution, so it's not going to be too long before it goes.
It's an incredible piece of art, and it's an incredible mechanism, or at least it would be if it worked.
The odds now to get it fixed are getting good because we have parts, which we didn't have before.
I worked on this ship about 10 years ago, and the clock wasn't working then.
It's never worked since the day it was put in the ship 17 years ago.
I really have no idea what I'm getting into. But this is what I got.
So the story of the clock continues. Carlos is now back with all the parts that he needs.
519732. Okay, this is the solenoid valve. Okay, let's see what this is. I think this is the actual time.
All kinds of people think they've got a plan to fix it. We've had a clock doctor come to look at it. He just looked and left, had no idea how it worked.
Many have tried and failed to get this clock working, so we're all anxious to see whether Carlos and Christian can make it happen.
Oh, my. Is this what we have to do?
Uh-huh. It's getting interesting. So the timer, which is this, has a piece called A1.
I wish him luck, but he hasn't got long. If it doesn't get fixed, the clock's got to go.
This side here will run the hour hand, and this side in here will run the minute hand. It's two totally different systems.
Start.
The controller, what it does, it just sends an impulse of air at certain time.
Okay.
See this thing? Look what happens. See? Mm-hmm. That's all the work that it does, is this. If you try to push it back, it's almost impossible.
And I put it here.
Did you see? That's the whole thing. That's the whole principle. So now we know the cylinder works. Okay, we have it all perfectly aligned in one point. Right there. So we have to count how many clicks it needs to do in one turn. Every 12 hours. Yes. 9, and please tell me it's 0:00.
0:00.
Oh, 120. Exactly. Okay, this one is 10 clicks per hour. So we have to set this thing to 10 per hour.
It's got to get it fixed or get rid of it.
Well, Kevin said to me, get a crane for 8 o'clock. If you don't get it, he's told you it's going to go.
It's the rules.
We're all behind you, Carlos. Absolutely.
They are setting up the crane to take it out at 8 in the morning if it doesn't work. Getting closer.
Can the clock be fixed on time?
It's a bit of a metaphor for the project.
We can watch the clock and see if we can get the clock working. Maybe we can get the rest of the project working.
Or will the...